Hi, my name is Prasad Kalakudimi. I'm the Director of Applied Technologies for ChemTreat. I have a PhD in electrochemistry and corrosion science. I've been in this industry for about 15 years in lead R&D roles and product management roles. Today, I'll be talking about cooling towers, some of the challenges associated with cooling towers, and touch upon a little bit on chemical treatment programs used in cooling tower applications. I'll also mention briefly about a proprietary and environmental friendly technology that ChemTreat developed called FlexPro technology. Let's get started. Some of you might be using phosphate and zinc based technologies as corrosion inhibitors in your system and might be wondering if there is an environmental friendly alternative for them. I will discuss about a proprietary FlexPro technology from ChemTreat, which is environmental friendly, non-fouling technology while providing superior corrosion inhibition for the system. We always start any of these meetings or trainings with a quick safety note. We are always concerned about compatibilities of various chemistries used in water treatment. Two chemistries that concerns me the most are sodium hypochlorite or bleach, which is used as a biocide, and any kind of acidic material such as sulfuric acid. We know that bleach is made by dissolving chlorine gas in caustic soda. So if it ever comes in contact with acidified materials or acidic materials, it will liberate chlorine gas in the form of a cloud. So storing the right products in right tanks is very essential to avoid any kind of hazardous reactions, not just with bleach, but with any other products as well. So just by the way of roadmap, again, I'm not going to get into too much of details about various cooling systems. The purpose of a cooling system, of course, is to remove heat from the process. And water is a wonderful material for that. Water has very good thermal conductivity and has very good heat transfer coefficient because of the strong hydrogen bonding. There are worrisome properties of water. Water is a universal solvent which will dissolve various minerals and can form scales, and water will grow bugs, and water is also very corrosive to metal. But these are three different types of cooling systems. Once through, it's pretty much like water in, water out. Closed loops, where generally you don't lose any water. The water goes round and round. And open evaporative cooling systems have been the workhorse of industrial cooling load. Basically, you know, the water gets circulated or cycled in a cooling tower, and evaporation process is explained in this picture. Let's say you start with 5 liters of water. Those marbles represent dissolved minerals in the water. And let's say you evaporate 4 liters and you're left with 1 liter. That means you're cycling your cooling tower 5 times, or we call it 5 cycles of concentration. Now see what is happening to the dissolved minerals. The dissolved minerals are getting seriously concentrated. There are various challenges associated with increasing this dissolved minerals. Some of these minerals have very low solubilities, and some of these sparingly soluble salts can become scales on metal surfaces at high temperatures. The issue is, you know, increase in dissolved salts will also make the water more corrosive. There are only 3 or 4 things that we have to worry about in cooling systems: corrosion, deposition, and biofouling. We consider this to be almost like a three-legged stool, where all these factors are very interconnected. If you have a lot of corrosion, you know, corrosion products will become deposits, or if you have biofouling, that can lead to bacterial growth. And most of these bacteria are very corrosive and acidic, and that can lead to microbiologically induced corrosion. Again, all these are very, very interconnected. At ChemTreat, we pretty much consider this to be a four-legged stool, where control and automation is also a key factor. Going into each one of them separately, you know, corrosion. How does corrosion happen is described in this picture. Every corrosion reaction is an electrochemical reaction, and water is a wonderful electrolyte for that. There is an oxidation happening at the anode, where iron is getting converted to iron 2+ or 3+, and the electrons are captured at the cathode, and various reactions can happen depending on the conditions. But typically in a cooling water applications, the most common cathodic reaction is the oxygen reduction to OH-. So these two reactions keeps happening and the corrosion reaction keeps continuing. Now, you know, you can add chemical treatment programs to control either of these reactions or both these reactions, and you can actually arrest the corrosion reaction. Now, depending on, you know, what reaction that you are stopping, your corrosion inhibitor chemicals are classified as either anodic or cathodic corrosion inhibitors. These are some of the examples of NRD corrosion inhibitors. Chromates were used for a long time before they were banned because of human health hazards. Since then, phosphates or orthophosphates have become products of choice for a long period of time. They work well, they're very inexpensive, they form barriers on the metal surface, and they have been used, let's say, since 1970s. But there are various issues associated with these technologies. For example, phosphates can react with calcium and can form calcium or a tricalcium phosphate scaling or calcium phosphate scaling on high temperature metal. And phosphates are also a wonderful nutrient for bacterial growth. Even though there are these challenges with phosphates, but phosphates have become products of choice for a long period of time. Molybdates and nitrites were also used as corrosion inhibitors in closed loop applications. These are some of your cathodic corrosion inhibitors. Zinc has been a workhorse cathodic corrosion inhibitor for a long period of time. It reacts with OH- at the cathode and forms zinc hydroxide film. But the challenge with zinc is its aquatic profile. Zinc is pretty toxic to aquatic life, and at least in the U.S., slowly started to get banned or discharge regulated in some parts of the U.S. Other phosphate salts can also act as cathodic corrosion inhibitors by reacting with calcium and forming films at the cathode. Now, how can we tell if a particular chemistry is anodic or cathodic corrosion inhibitor? Is by using electrochemistry. This is a schematic of the electrochemical setup where you have a working reference and counter electrodes. Basically, working electrode is the electrode of choice or interest, where you apply external voltage and measure the current response using this potentiostat. And then from the voltage current response, you can actually derive various corrosion characteristics of these working electrode. This is the actual electrochemical setup at our corporate laboratory in Richmond, Virginia. So this is the voltage current response of various treatment programs. Now, if you do not have any treatment program and you just have blank water, your voltage current response looks like this. The flat line where the line actually meets the voltage axis is open circuit potential. The x-axis is current density. Now, when you add, let's say, 5 ppm of zinc, you see a large reduction in the current on the cathodic side, which is basically below the open circuit potential. That indicates that zinc is a wonderful cathodic corrosion inhibitor. Now, when you add, let's say, 15 ppm of PO4, you see the open circuit potential going more positive, indicating that the electrode is getting passivated. And there is a large reduction in the current on the anodic side, indicating phosphate is a wonderful anodic corrosion inhibitor. Now, because of the issues associated with phosphate and zinc-based programs, ChemTreat has developed a proprietary non-phosphorus, non-zinc programs called FlexPro technology. You can see what happens when we add 12.5 ppm of our FlexPro technology. There is a huge reduction in the current on the cathodic side, and also there is a huge reduction in the current on the anodic side, and the open circuit potential also is increased, which means the electrode is very passive. And FlexPro is a synergistic combination of anodic and cathodic corrosion inhibitors. Again, you can obtain a lot of this information and case histories of FlexPro technology on our website. But FlexPro is a wonderful flexible corrosion inhibitor developed by ChemTreat. And it's non-fouling, unlike phosphate-based programs. So it's easy to control, basically feed what you need for your application. Inhibitor film is much more persistent and shown to inhibit corrosion on multimetals. And it's a proprietary technology as well. Like I said, we have many applications, many case histories, but this is one of the case histories where we compared a phosphate program and a FlexPro program on heat exchanger surface using a deposit monitor. You see with the phosphate program on the top, as we increase the heat to boil temperature to up to 130, you see our heat transfer resistance increasing, indicating calcium phosphate scaling. With our non-phosphorus FlexPro program, even with up to 150 Fahrenheit, the heat transfer resistance pretty much remains flat, indicating that our FlexPro technology is a non-fouling technology while providing superior corrosion inhibition. The other factor that we have to worry about is biofouling. Again, nothing can bring your system down like microbiological growth. Microbes love warm waters and sunlight and pH 6 to 9, which are all perfect conditions in a cooling water application. Microbiological growth also happens in log growth, which means that the biofouling can happen faster than your mineral scales and can be more destructive many times. How do we control? You know, we use a chemistry called biocides. There are two classes of biocides, oxidizing and non-oxidizing biocides. Oxidizing biocides like chlorine, bromine, and chlorine dioxide, basically they oxidize and the microorganisms. Non-oxidizers work on slightly different poisoning processes. such as interfering with cell reproduction and stopping respiration, etc. The challenge with oxidizing biocides is just because they cannot differentiate between a microorganism or any organic molecule in the water. They pretty much try to go after anything that they can oxidize. And sometimes that can create some harmful byproducts, such as trihalomethanes. To mitigate that, ChemTreat has developed a technology called SurfClean 4515, which is a patented halogen stabilizer and a biopenetrant. Basically, this chemistry converts the free chlorine into a total available chlorine and can release on demand. It's got much better biofilm penetration. And more than anything else, this chemistry does not require any US EPA registrations. And this will also reduce harmful byproducts. So please obtain more information about this on our website. The other factor we have to consider is the deposition. Deposition can be of two types. Scaling, basically, once you exceed the saturation limits of some of these sparingly soluble salts, you can form mineral scales on the heat exchanger surfaces. And fouling is basically used because of the suspended matter coming from makeup water or dust that the cooling tower is scrubbing from the air can cause fouling. The reasons for these are alternate water sources because of water scarcities in some part of the world. People are looking at alternate water sources such as reclaimed waters and reused waters, which are prone to undergo a lot of deposition issues. Cost of water, again, is another factor why people are looking at low-quality water sources for their cooling towers. And EH&S also is playing a big role. How do we control scaling is by using scale inhibitor chemistries. There are two classes of chemistries which are mainly used. Organic phosphates, basically good sequestrants. They have very high electronegative charges on them. So they can actually sequester some of these cations such as calciums and does not let them come together to form scales. Polymers are wonderful crystal modifiers, we call them. This SEM image shows, you know, without an inhibitor, you have the orderly growth of these crystals and they come together to form scales. Once you add a polymeric inhibitor, you see the crystals are distorted at the edges. And these distorted crystals generally does not come together well and they actually tend to redissolve in the water and stop any kind of precipitation. The last slide is on control. Basically, irrespective of what industry you are from, you cannot make a quality product at low cost without investing in automation and software. Automation is a combination of hardware and softwares. Hardware is basically all the sensors and controllers and everything. And software is basically taking all the data from these sensors and making smart choices to operate your cooling tower efficiently and effectively. ChemTreat CT Vista platform is one example where we can use wonderful hardware and software controls to operate your cooling tower very efficiently and effectively. Thank you very much for your time today and thanks for following along. If you have any other questions, please visit ChemTreat website to find out more information. Thank you.